A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Bangunan Sulaiman on this bright, sunny Wednesday afternoon, Wednesday evening rather. Today's talk is titled Mediating All Gas Engineering and Construction Disputes. And to take us through this evening, we have our main presenter, Dr. Robert Gaitskell. And joining him in front are David Milden and Andrew Marillis. Moderating this session is Tan Sri Dato VC George. A brief introduction of your moderator before I hand over the microphone. Tan Sri VC is a former Court of Appeal judge who was called to the English Bar from Lincoln's Inn in 1956 and was a legal practitioner at the bar in Malaysia from 1957 until 1980. After his retirement from the bench, he worked as a consultant with a legal firm and has also been an arbitrator since 1996 and is involved in both domestic and international arbitrations. Ladies and gentlemen, can we please put our hands together for Tan Sri VC?
Thank you. Thank you, Franz. we have to use these microphones because what is being said here is being recorded. So, Raj, no seditious statements from you when it comes to question time. I will start off by introducing the guest speaker, Dr. Robert Gaitskell QC. He is the only other animal of his type that I know of in Malaysia. Raj Navaratnam was sitting here, an engineer as well as a lawyer. Dr. Gaitskell started his professional career as an engineer, graduated from University of Cape Town in electrical engineering and went on eventually to get a PhD. That must have been in your engineering field, isn't it? Engineering and law, I see. And then he went on to read law and University of London, King's College, I think. And anyway, that is well years ago behind him. Since then, he's gone on to become recognized as a top engineer who's also a top lawyer. So he's got his PhD, he's involved in a whole lot of engineering institutions and so on. I won't go into the details because it will take us 15 minutes for me to go through that. And then he took silk in 1994, and is in great demand as an international as well as domestic in England, but international arbitrations. Recognized as a specialist in the gas and oil and power production, you know, that disputes arising from that kind of situations. I think somewhere else I got it down as the energy. What's the word, David? You use it somewhere. Energy disputes arising out of the energy industry, if I may put it that. That covers oil, gas, electricity, that kind of thing. Dr. Gaitskell is here sitting, chairing a tribunal, arbitral tribunal, and it's a dispute arising out of power purchase agreement. So that's, you know, well within his field. And he's been persuaded to come and talk to us about subject mediating oil, gas, engineering and construction disputes. I'm reminded of some many years ago at a bar meeting of the bar, annual meeting of the bar, Mahadev Shankar, who later became a judge, got up and suggested that we should do away with claims arising out of motor insurance, motor accidents. He said that we should have some sort of follow the New Zealand legislation and have a no-fault kind of a situation, so you don't You don't have to go and prove negligence. You simply show that you are, you prove that you were involved in an accident, you were injured, and then you they quantify the claim and the insurance companies will pay you. So at that meeting, I got up and tongue in cheek, really, but some people took me seriously. I said, people like Shankar shouldn't be allowed to come and speak to us because one of the most lucrative branches of the profession is motor claims and damages arising on motor claims. And people like Shankar shouldn't be allowed to speak. It may be a coincidence. Shortly after that, I was elected to be president of the bar. Now, Dr. Gaitskell is going to talk about mediation, and I noticed in some notes that he passed on to me that he talking about it as being cheapest way of sorting out disputes arising out of oil, gas, engineering, construction. Generally, on any type of dispute, mediation is a cheaper way of doing it. But I'm not sure whether we should allow people like him to come and talk to us, because what's going to become to all of you aspiring arbitrators? There won't be any more disputes to arbitrate. Now, Dr. Gaitskell has collared my other friend, David Milden, who's sitting on my left, QC. He's from, Robert Gaitskell is from Keating Chambers, very well-known set of chambers in London. David Milden is from Essex Court Chambers, there are 2-3 Essex Court Chambers, another well-known set of construction. Both of them are involved in the, I think these sets are really experts on construction laws, isn't it? At least they do all sorts of things, but they both of them have known in the field of energy, the energy industry. And Robert Gaitskell has called David Milden, they're sitting together in an arbitration, to assist him in the first part of his presentation, which is going to be a mock mediation. It's all very well to talk about mediation, but he very cleverly, I think we'll appreciate it, we appreciate it very much that he's worked out, done a lot of work, I saw some of the script that he wrote, to give a demonstration of how mediation actually works. It's a mock mediation. But he's asked me to remind you that normally in real life, this would probably take a whole day, the mediation process. There'll be to-ing and fro-ing, the mediator probably going from one room to the other, talking and probably bullying the parties to come to shake hands on a deal. So he's got David Milden to assist him in that mock mediation. And they needed another person, and there came Andrew Merrillis, who is with Hill International. He's not a lawyer, so you'll appreciate he looks good. He's a good-looking fellow. Most lawyers are not. And his background is a quantity surveyor. And he's with Hill International, and as some of you involved in the world of arbitration know that they are, they provide expertise in quantification, in all sorts of disputes, largely, I think, the field of arbitration. And the Hill International got a presence in here, Singapore, Hong Kong, I think in Hong Kong in a big way. And so Robert called him, just met him actually, and said, right, you will be the other person in this mediation, mock mediation exercise. So this, Robert tells me he should be able to finish that in about half an hour, after which he will present his lecture, about half an hour, and then there'll be question time, so try and think of some questions to make it interesting. On that note, Robert, can I pass the mic to you? Ladies and gentlemen, round of applause for Dr. Robert Gaitskell. Because after it's all over, you may just slink away.
Well, good evening, David and Andrew. I'm very pleased you were both able to come along today to see if we can mediate your dispute. It's got lots of interesting features in it. I see that basically it's got to do with the supply of pipes in the oil industry, and I see that you, David, are a manufacturer, and you've been supplying the pipes onto a big oil rig manufacturer. Before we actually get down to the details of the dispute, I thought I'd just remind you of one of the big drivers for why mediation is so successful, and it is. It has a success rate of something like 70 to 80% in this particular field. And one of the drivers is that when we get together for a mediation, there's confidentiality kicking in at two different levels. First of all, there's a complete umbrella over this. So if you don't get a deal today, you won't be able to tell anyone about the details of the mediation. You won't be able to tell a judge or an arbitrator about what happened here. And that gives you a lot of freedom, because it means you can make concessions for the purposes of the mediation, which, if you don't get a deal, you can take off the table and forget that they ever got made. And the second level at which there's confidentiality is when I'm in a caucus session, a private session, with either David or with you, Andrew. Whatever is said in that session stays in that session. I don't transmit anything from one caucus room to the other, and that means you can be totally frank with me, and that enables me to see what sort of deal would be able to satisfy both of you. So that's one of the big drivers for why we'll get a deal today. And David, could we start with you? Would you outline how you see the dispute?
Thank you, Robert. Perhaps I should just introduce myself for the benefit of yourself and indeed Andrew. My name is David Topp. And as you probably deduced from my surname, Top Pipings Limited is a family business. It was set up over 40 years ago by my father, Alfred Topp, and we've been in the business of manufacturing pipes for all of that time. I'm here accompanied by my lawyer, Advocate Ghost. He's the apparition that you can see there to my left, and he's been very helpful to me. Now, a few more words about the problem we have. We've never had a problem of this kind in the entire history of the business, but essentially what went wrong is this, that we supply pipes in a very large number of sizes. There really has been absolutely no problem, even in relation to this transaction, with 90% of our pipes. There was, however, a problem with what we call the shorties. Now, the shorties are not people of rather diminutive stature. The shorties are simply the shortest pipes that we make. And we had a problem with them because we thought that we could increase production applying a corrosion prevention mechanism to the short pipes by treating two at once rather than treating them all as singletons. It has transpired that in one or two isolated cases that hasn't worked properly. And hence, here we are in this dispute. Now, what I want to say a little bit about, firstly, where I'm coming from the heart, and I'll come to where the head is leading me in a minute, but I feel I need to get off my chest why this has become such an aggravating matter from our point of view. The facts of the matter is that the number of short pipes that we supplied was a tiny proportion of the total. As soon as we discovered what had gone wrong, we offered to replace all the short pipes free of charge and to pay 200,000 euros, the estimated cost of replacing all the short pipes, whether defective or not, that we had previously supplied with new short pipes that would have been the subject of the correct corrosion control treatment. It seemed to us that that would provide a complete solution to the problem that we faced. Regrettably, Super Drilling Limited, their representatives, you will have gathered by Mr. Super, who's the man in the blue suit over there and the blue tie. Super Drilling's approach to the problem was, as we see it, really just to escalate it by going around the marketplace telling everybody that there was a problem with all our pipes, not just the shorties, as a result of which our business has collapsed in terms of turnover, and we have really had been the subject of the most slanderous comments about our pipes, all of which was completely unwarranted, save in relation to this very narrow category. We take the view that we have a perfectly good claim for at least €1 million and possibly more, arising out of the damage to our business caused by all these scurrilous statements. Now, I said I'd start by speaking from the heart, and that's where we're coming from. And on any view, it seems to us that where we are now, any payment must come to us rather than go the other way. But let's turn to what the head is telling me. It is a fact that we have been in business with Mr. Super and his company for a long time. We have done an enormous number of very high-value transactions with him, and his company is extremely successful in the oil rig business. And we have no interest in terminating that relationship for all time and terminating it on an acrimonious note. That will end up, we fear, with a situation where we all lose. What we are really interested in is to try and establish how on earth there can possibly be any real exposure on the part of Mr. Super and his company to claims by third parties in relation to these short or shorty pipes, as I've been calling them, because as we understand it, that's his real gripe. He's concerned that other people may sue him where he has supplied these very limited quantity of defective pipes and he's installed them in their oil rigs. Well, as I said already, in relation to the only one rig that we're aware of, we've offered to replace all the pipes and we really cannot see that there is any substance in the suggestion that he and his company are exposed. So let's just see where that leads us in terms of the bottom line and what we're really looking for here. I've already said that we've made a proposal that we would pay 200,000 euros towards the cost of replacing the short pipes, and that remains on the table. But we really see no basis on which we could be asked to pay any more. Can I just conclude with one or two observations about what I'm being told by Advocate Ghost here on my left? He points out that we are here in the Republic of Xania, and Mr. Super operates in the Kingdom of Ravitania. And that we don't have any jurisdiction clause in our agreements,
The situation is one where if Mr. Super and his company wants to proceed against us, and he tries to sue us in Ruritania, I'm being told that no Ruritanian judgment would be enforceable here, and we only have our assets here. Equally, I'm being told that if we were to start proceedings here against Mr. Super's company, we would likely get a very sympathetic hearing from some of the very experienced commercial judges we have here, including the very illustrious-looking gentleman who was sitting in the now vacant chair. On the basis of that very reliable advice from Advocate Ghost, we really see no basis on which we should be increasing the proposal that we previously put on the table. I hope that's a helpful start, but that's where we're coming from, Robert.
David, thank you for outlining how you see things. Andrew, I wonder if you could tell us how it looks to you.
Thank you for that, Mr. Top. That was a very candid and opening statement. That's very much appreciated. My name is Mr. Super, and I am the CEO of Super Drilling Limited. The opening statement from Mr. Top, as I said, was a very candid opening statement. But I just want to go straight to the heart of the matter. As said, Top Drilling are the supplier to ourselves, and we supply that to the main platform, Zender 7 platform. As said, we've been doing very good business with the Top Piping for a number of years now, and they fully understand that we supply the pipe and other equipment for installation and use in the offshore oil projects. However, that equipment must be inter-oil certified. That's the whole point. There's no point that we take these shorty pipes from the supplier and deliver them and install to Zender 7 if they're defective. The environment that these shorties are used in is in the seawater, obviously, so they're highly prone to corrosion. That is a fundamental requirement at the heart of our relationship with Mr. Top, and also to meet our customer requirements and expectations. That is the reason we sought out Top Piping in the first place, because they had inter-oil certification. Anything that is reason we sought out the Top Piping in the first place. Anything that undermines that certification has a devastating effect on our business and reputation in the marketplace. Frankly, I'm at a loss why Top Building had the change in the manufacturing process and undermined our relationship by misrepresenting a certified product, where that previous certificate was voided by their undisclosed action. We are very extremely disappointed by Top Piping's behaviour, and that has put us in a position where we are exposed to potentially considerable claims for damages on the Zender Pride 7 platform and potentially other jobs. Top Piping are aware of that. All of this stems from their actions which contravene Inter-Oil's certification conditions. The idea that we somehow caused a loss of business by complying with our duty of care to warn the customers of the issue is a complete fallacy and personally downright offensive. We cannot be held liable for the so-called €1 million loss of business a year which has been touted around in the marketplace. I am here because I do want this matter resolved and to move on, if that is possible.
Right. Well, thank you for that, Andrew. Would you like to have some coffee now while I have a quick chat with David? David, I was very interested in what you were saying there, and I think it's a good start that you reiterated that you're prepared to put that €200,000 on the table as a manifest of your good faith in trying to get a deal today. Tell me, from your point of view, continuing a productive business relationship with super drilling, that must hold the possibility of enormous future work for you. Is that right?
That's unquestionably true. But they're not our only customer, and I don't want it to be thought that we should be absolutely desperate to preserve that relationship. We're very keen to.
Right. Well, thanks for that, because I'm sure that we can find some package that will satisfy both parties. And where there's the potential for enormous business going forward, as there is here, it makes it much easier to get a decent deal. You did mention that if we couldn't get a deal today and it had to go in front of a judge, you mentioned that it might go in front of Tan Sri Dato VC George. Now, well, we all know what he's like. He's a very difficult judge, isn't he?
Well, my advocate Ghost is telling me he is indeed very difficult, but that we're likely to succeed in front of him.
Right. Well, I think we'll park that one, and we might have to come back to it. Now, I'm going to have a confidential chat with Andrew in just a moment. Without me taking anything from this caucus room to that caucus room, could you give me some idea of how you'd view some arrangement whereby you'd be able to help meet his exposure up the line to the oil rig manufacturer that he's been supplying pipes to? You've mentioned your 200,000, but beyond that, if you've got a business relationship going forward, you'll be making a profit in the future, and you'd be able perhaps to supply pipes to him at cost, so that he can be recouping some of his losses up the line over a period of time from you. How would that sound?
Well, we're always willing to listen to any proposal. And if what you're suggesting, Robert, is that we might be able to arrive at some sort of package in which we were offered participation in another rig as large as the recent one, well, obviously, we would look at it and see whether there was some way in which we could supply pipes at a particularly favourable price. But as I reiterated a moment ago, I mean, our bottom line really is that in the present transaction should be resolved with a net payment coming our way. So, I think that's as far as we can go at the moment, really.
Right. Well, thanks for that. You have some coffee, and I'll have a chat with Andrew.
Thank you, Robert.
Well, Andrew, I'm really pleased you were able to get away from the business today to be here, because I know you've spent a lot of time having to keep your clients happy in the light of all the difficulties that you've had. I think what would be an important feature of any deal with David would be if you could give him some assurance that there's a lot of business to be had going forward supplying pipes to oil rig manufacturers. Is that something you can help on?
Thank you, Robert. Yes, that's exactly the point. David Topp and his company He keeps saying that they have only agreed for 200,000 million euro, but we spent a lot of time on dealing with the client, dealing with Sender Pride 7, getting them satisfied, doing lots of inspections, and that's why the cost went to 1.25 million euro. We spent a lot of time. We gave them a lot of confidence to come back to us, and there's the potential that an even larger contract, the Platform 8, will be given to us in the short term. And that sort of relationship we would like to keep, obviously, with the big clients. And if Top Piping are interested, then obviously we would like to keep them as well. So therein lies the point. That was the cause of the cost increase. We had a meeting with Top Piping whereby we said that we would do all these additional inspections, and that was agreed. So there's obviously been a breakdown in communication and that cost going back to Top Piping. One other aspect is Ender Pride also wrote to us threatening 5 million euros of damages for the potential late completion of the Platform 7. And that's why we responded with these detailed expert reports. We have given them assurances, and obviously that cost has increased. I've given assurance to my board that I will get back that 1.25 million euros. The whole problem stems from Top Piping giving the two shorter pipes at the same time within the heat convector, as opposed to only one, thereby the certification has been voided, and there was a delay of 3 to 4 weeks to the actual Platform 7 project. We have spent a lot of money and time to manage these issues, and we have nearly secured the Zender 8 platform. However, we need cash, and we need it now.
Right. And if I were able to come back to you, having chatted to David, with a package that, say, perhaps looked like 200,000 in euros immediately to help your cash flow, and then the remaining 1 million odd to give you your 1.25 ultimately, spread out so that you get it by way of him supplying pipes at cost until you've recouped your additional expenditure. And then, of course, with the new oil rigs that will flow from the business you're doing up the line, you'll both be able to make a profit after that. How would that sound?
I mean, that's the whole point. We want to keep that relationship. We still think that they're a good supplier of those shorter pipes. They've been reinstated that inter-oil certification now. That sort of deal, 200,000 up front now, and the balance being paid over on interim payments up to the 1.25. That's, we can do that, yeah.
Right, well, yeah. Have another cup of coffee. I'll chat
Thanks.
With him.
Nice coffee.
Right, well, I've had what I hope is a useful chat with Andrew, and he thinks a package is certainly possible where you come up with 200,000 in actual cash now, because he's got a cash flow problem, and he needs a total package of 1.25, so the remaining 850,000 can be structured on the basis that you supply him with cost-priced pipes, where he will be not having to pay you the profit on those, but the profit margin will be going into funding the 850,000. Once he's recouped that, then you go back to applying your profit in the usual way, and there's a lot of business coming because of these enormous oil rigs that he's now supplying. So that looks like the sort of package that we could work on. How does that sound?
Well, Robert, this is fairly ingenious, I must say. My immediate reaction is that if you structure the deal in the way you've just suggested, we could end up just having an argument about what our profit margin was, and then how long one needed to go on supplying pipes in order to create a benefit to John that was equivalent to, sorry, to Andrew, equivalent to what he says he wants. I'm not over excited about that, but I'm just wondering, can I try something different on you? Just tell me what you think about this. The total consideration on this Zvenda thing that you now know rather more about than you did before you started helping us was about 10 million euros. Now, I've just been looking with my cost people at what we might do on the next big project, which I gather may be in the pipeline, if you'll forgive the pun. And we reckon that we could probably do we reckon that the pipes, the average cost of the pipes in the project we've just done, the average invoice price was about $90 a meter of length. That's just an average. And if we reckon we could probably get that down to 80. And we're just wondering whether a better way forward, and that's by cutting our profit really to the bone, if a better way forward was to see whether we could simply agree a discount on the next project, because there's no room for argument. I mean, the price is the price. We'll get paid less. But he will be presumably able to make a much bigger profit than he would otherwise be able to be make out of his next project. Do you think that's worth pursuing, or what do you think?
I think that we're on the home stretch now. All we need to do is, if you could bring in your accountant, who will know what sort of discount you're able to give, and that will enable us to get the figure per meter that is going to contributing to his 850,000, and he's confident that there's limitless supply prospects now with forthcoming oil rigs. So it looks very promising to me.
Yeah, I mean, just to get it clear, and what I was suggesting really is that there'd be a discounted price on the next big project, and I'm assuming that the total volume of that order will be probably slightly higher in terms of the overall length of piping than the recent one, simply because I've been told it's a bigger project. So my suggestion would be that we'll give a discounted rate per meter on that particular project. It won't roll forward if there's another project beyond that, when we'll be negotiating that in the usual way. But if it's limited to the forthcoming project, then subject to seeing exactly what the volume of piping is, my cost accountant who looks at all of these things is telling me that we could probably, as I say, give a $10 discount per meter, subject to seeing exactly what the length of piping is that we're talking about. What do you think? Would you like to see whether that's worth pursuing? It would be very helpful if you could.
Yes. Well, I think what I'll do now is suggest to Andrew that he brings in his chief design engineer, who will be able to give us specific figures for how much piping there is.
Yes.
If you can get your accountant on the phone, and we could get them talking to each other.
I'll certainly do that. I'll get my accountant on the phone, and that will probably be rather better for me than having yet another cup of coffee. Thank you, Robert.
Right. Well, Andrew, I wonder if you'd come through. I think you two have both been very sensible, and you could shake hands on a deal in principle. Yes. And if you can bring your chief engineer in, David's going to bring his accountant in, and they can talk to each other. And I think there's a way forward. So well done.
All right. Well, I mean, we all know that inside every good lawyer is a good actor. Mm. So, ladies and gentlemen, I give you Clint Eastwood sitting there. Mm. And from Andrew's accent, he obviously is Sean Connery. And Robert. Hi, Marlon.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and now I've resumed my true persona, and I'm going to talk at high speed and very succinctly about mediation in the oil, gas, and energy industries, and I'd like to start just by dealing with a point that VC George made about, does this take work away from lawyers? And the answer is, it might look like it does, but in fact it doesn't. Now, people think that it does, there's no doubt. I was talking to a mediator from Karachi recently. He told me, he was a young, dynamic lawyer, and he and some of his colleagues got together. They hired a room, they put the Karachi Mediation Center up in a very nice sign above the door. 3 days later, the lawyers in Karachi marched down and burnt the building down. So, the warning is, be careful if you embark on this course of action. But it, in fact, does not cut your work in the way that people think. I can say that with total confidence, because in the set of chambers I'm in, when I joined it, I was number 13. This is many years back. But every year since then, we've recruited, and now we're about 55, 56 barristers. And we've never stopped recruiting. We've never had a downturn. And we embraced mediation when it came along. And it's a relatively new animal in the UK. It came from the US. I got involved right at the outset because I could see in about 1989 that when it first appeared in the UK that this had a lot to offer. And I'm going to talk about what it has to offer in just a moment. And it proved just as good as I was expecting. And it doesn't cut the work for the simple reason that when your clients see that you're able to offer them a technique that can save them time and costs and get them a deal, what they do is bring you a lot more work. And disputes that people were going to very reluctantly decide to live with because they didn't want to pay lawyers lots of money, they now have mediated. And so a lot more work comes into the market, a lot more disputes actually get dealt with, and it doesn't cut down the amount of work overall that the lawyers have. So it really does work. Now, what I'm going to do is just about mediation, but one of the drivers for it, I mentioned when I was talking to two people in the dispute about the confidentiality being very important. Another hugely important aspect is that you can get everybody you want into the mediation. The difficulty with arbitration clauses is they apply to the people who've signed up to the agreement that's got the arbitration clause in it. Mediation has no restrictions. You can invite to a mediation anyone you want to. You'll see up on the chart the sort of people that could be involved in an oil and gas type of dispute. Your employer, your contractor, consulting engineer for the project, and expert engineers and so on. Now, a few years ago, a group of people came to me and said, there's been a big collapse of a major infrastructure project somewhere in the world. There were disputes between six parties, engineers, contractors, and so on. But each of those parties was in dispute with its insurers. And so they asked me to do the mediation for the engineering aspects, and they brought in a well-known insurance mediator that I know in London, and he was to do the insurance aspect. So we had 12 effective parties, two lots of six, and we needed somewhere to have caucus rooms for all of these people. So what we did was, the Emirates Stadium, where Arsenal Football Club play, we hired the stadium because they have wonderful rooms for corporate entertaining all stretched around. And so we took 12 rooms for the parties. There was a room for my colleague and I, and another room for when we took people out from their rooms to have private sessions in. And my colleague and I became very fit because we had to run between all of these rooms, and we spread our mediation over a period of 6 months, not every day, but every week or every 2 weeks we'd have a big session, but in between we'd have phone calls and this party talk to that party and so on, and at the end of the 6 months we got a deal, everybody was happy. And it would have been impossible to do in a conventional arbitration or litigation because there weren't all the right contracts with arbitration clauses in them. But we were able to get everybody who was interested to come along and participate. So that's a big advantage. Now, the other huge advantage, and this is probably the biggest incentive for getting a deal with mediation, is that it addresses issues that will never get addressed otherwise. And I can give you some very telling examples. Let me go straight to those. A colleague of mine, so this is not my mediation, but a colleague of mine was involved in a dispute where on the one side, a man working on an oil rig had been involved in an industrial accident and had died. And the insurers who were expected to pay out were refusing on the basis that he had been grossly negligent in what he did on the oil rig and had caused his own death. So they weren't going to budge. So the mediation gets together with all the people involved. But principally, sitting on the one side were six lawyers from this very big insurance company, all in their black suits, all with frowns on their faces, arms folded, and there they were. They weren't going to pay out a cent. On the other side, which is the estate of the poor worker who died, no one has turned up. My friend is the mediator, and he's sitting there and wringing his hands because he can't do a mediation unless someone turns up to represent the estate of the deceased. Eventually, the door opens, and they're all waiting for the lawyers for the deceased estate to come in. No lawyer comes. Instead, a little old lady comes in carrying a bag, and she comes and she sits down, and after her come three children, one of about 12, one of about 8, and one of 4. and they all neatly get onto their chairs and they sit there. There's total silence, and she leans down into her bag, and there's much rustling of paper, and she comes up with a photograph, and she puts the photograph on the table, and she says, "That's my late husband." So everyone gets very uncomfortable and they shift in their seats. And then she bends down and puts her hand into the bag, and she comes up with an urn. And she puts the urn on the table. And she says, "That's my late husband." Now the insurers are really embarrassed at this point. And she said, "I'm here to get justice for my orphan children." And the lead lawyer for the insurers said, "How much do you want?" And he wrote a check, handed it over, and the mediation was over. Now, you cannot get that sort of thing in court or arbitration. You can get it in mediation because it's addressing issues that otherwise will never come to the surface. Let me give you another example of that. This happened in the north of England. The president of a very autocratic, dictatorial country was visiting and meeting David Cameron and so on. And he was going up to this northern city on an official visit. And in that northern city, there was a big of a minority group in his home country, and they were being persecuted in the home country, and so this group wanted to have a demonstration, and they informed the police, "We want to have a peaceful demonstration, stand there with our placards saying don't persecute us in our home country." And the police said, "Well, freedom of speech, okay, you can turn up, but we don't want any trouble." And they said there won't be any trouble. So they turned up, and they were quite sizable in number. And what had happened was the police in England have a technique which they call kettling, where if there's a big group of protesters that they want to gain control of, they put a cordon around them, and they don't allow them to go to the toilets or get water and so on. So it's like a kettle. They are seething and boiling, but they're totally controlled because they can't move because the police have got them. And these people were kettled, and they were kept well away from where this very grand president was, who was visiting. So he didn't even see them, but they were feeling very aggrieved. And so after the visit was over, they decided they were going to bring an action for breach of their human rights because they'd been mistreated in this way. And somehow, someone with common sense had suggested, before it all got into court, they should have a mediation. And so a colleague of mine was the mediator, and he said what happened was amazing. On the one side are all these men in their blue police tunics and fancy hats with gold all over them, and on the other side are the representatives of this minority persecuted group, and they're all sitting glowering at each other. And the first thing that happens is the most senior policeman gets up and says, "Before we start, I simply want to say how sorry we are. We totally misunderstood the situation. You had warned us you were going to be entirely peaceful, and in fact you were entirely peaceful. No one tried to throw anything. No one tried to misbehave in any way. We misjudged it. We got it wrong. We'll never do it again, and we'd like to apologize unreservedly." At which point, the people on the other side, the persecuted minority, came and hugged the policeman. Well, I don't think the policeman had been hugged very much, but anyway, after they'd all hugged each other, the persecuted minority group said, "We withdraw our action. We're not interested in going to court. We simply wanted to make our point, and you've accepted it." And so that was a hugely successful mediation. So you can see that mediation can address issues that you will never be even aware exist, because litigation doesn't cater for that. Litigation caters for what's your cause of action, have you got a contract, what tortious right have you got? And you can move far beyond that with mediation. Now, I'm very conscious of the time, so I'm going to keep things very short. But I think is the third big driver for the success of mediation. I've talked about confidentiality, I've talked about addressing all these other issues, but it's time and costs. Time-wise, you can expect to get a deal, as I say, 70 to 80% of cases will get a deal, and you can expect to get the deal within a day, sometimes 2 or 3 days. If you've got a really complex oil rig dispute, it can take maybe 3 days. And the costs associated with that are minuscule compared to what you're going to spend if you have a major piece of litigation or arbitration. And you avoid all the expenditure on discovery and disclosure. You can generally avoid having experts' reports because you have the mediation at an early stage before you've done all that. And so you've saved a lot of costs. Now, because it's such a flexible arrangement, you get to do mediations in some strange places because people are able to do them anywhere you'd like. I was once on an island somewhere, I won't tell you where, but on an island doing a mediation. And it was all highly confidential, so we weren't allowed to do it in the capital city because on this island, if we had, everyone would know what we were doing. So we were doing it in a church hall out in the countryside on the island. And so we started at 9:30 in the morning, and the mediation went on all day. And there was a nice lady from the church who was coming in, making us tea and made us sandwiches, and that was all very nice. And she was floating in and out, and we smiled and said hello to her. And mediations often run into the evening when you're getting close to a deal, you don't want to stop, and it became 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, we got the deal. So everybody shakes hands, we've signed up to everything, and we go to the door, and the door's locked. So we look around for the nice little old lady who'd been giving us tea, and she's gone home. So then everybody's onto their phones trying to phone people, and eventually we managed to get the clergyman for the church, who lived miles away in the capital, who had to drive out in order to let us out. And this was the revenge of the little old lady, because she obviously got very annoyed with us staying as late as we had. So those are unexpected aspects of mediation. You don't get those generally if you're doing an arbitration, certainly with VC George. He runs a very tight ship. So you'll always be allowed out of the hall if he's there. And I mentioned that you can avoid having experts' reports, which of course will save you a lot of money. And you always need to be very cautious with experts' reports. There's an English case from 3 or 4 years ago called BSB. And if ever you're bored, I suggest you read it. It's a fairly lengthy judgment, but the best part is what I'm about to tell you. This expert gets called, and he's asked about his qualifications, and he says he has an MBA from some university in the northern part of Canada, and it's got a campus elsewhere and so on, and he's been there, and he's got this MBA. And he gets cross-examined about this, but he assures everybody he's a very competent expert and is able to give evidence that's going to persuade the judge. The following morning, after he's been cross-examined, the barrister who cross-examined him comes to court and says he'd like to tell the court about his experience on the previous night. He had gone onto the website for this university that awarded an MBA to the expert, and he said, I discovered it's a university where all you have to do is put in your name and your credit card number, and you will get a degree by return. So he said, first of all, I put in my name, John Smith, and I got a second-class degree by return. So he said, I was very interested in this. Why had I only got a second-class degree when I'd given my payment? So I put in my dog's name, Lulu, and I put in my credit card again, and Lulu got a better degree than I did. She got a 2-1. So, of course, after this evidence came out, the expert's credibility was totally destroyed. But, of course, he charged for producing a very lengthy report. And all of this you can read about in the judgment. So I'll wrap that up at this point. But the key thing to take away from what you've seen tonight is that mediation works. It will not take away lawyers' work. It works because it's got real advantages in time and costs, in flexibility in where you can hold it, when you can hold it, and you avoid all the hassle of discovery, disclosure, and lots of experts' reports. It's got to be worth trying, and provided you don't try it in Karachi, you're okay.
Well, thank you, Robert. it's question time. Robert says he will field questions.
All of us, yes.
There'll be contribution from all of us, hopefully. Are there any? There should be a few questions. This is a new, yes. Identify yourself so that we'll know who you are.
Hello, my name's Isaac. Good evening. We enjoyed your mock mediation. just wanted to ask, I mean, all these things sound excellent, but what is the enforceability of this kind of mediation? And a lot of people always say that mediation is not statutory or it's not enforceable, doesn't have finality. Can you give us some highlights from your side? Thank you.
I'll start off, but I'm sure my colleagues can add to it. What gives it enforceability is that once you've got the deal, and of course the parties have total control right up to the moment that they do a deal. So if you don't want to take whatever terms are on offer, you don't, you've got control. But when the point comes where you do want to do the deal, you sign it, it becomes a binding contract. One of the rules that all the major mediation bodies use is that there must be a signed contract. Of course, under the common law, you don't have to have a written contract. You can do it orally. But for the purposes of mediation, there has to be a written contract. And that's for certainty. And so once you've signed it, dated it, you've got a contract and you can enforce the contract. So that if one party wants to pull out, you simply go to court and sue on the contract. But in my experience, people don't pull out because they've spent the whole day or 2 days discussing it with their opposite number so that when they do the deal, they're prepared to follow through on that. And because both parties have reached it after thinking it through in a lot of detail, they're prepared to stand by it, which of course is quite different from if you go in front of some judge, he makes a decision, there's a winner and a loser, and the loser feels the judge didn't understand what I was saying, I didn't get a fair hearing or whatever, and then they resist the judgment by trying to appeal it and so on. But in my experience, you don't get that in mediation because the parties have voluntarily signed up to it.
Yeah, the thing to remember is that it's not an adjudication. You mustn't think in terms of an adjudication. You're getting two parties to shake hands, as we saw in the demonstration. They were talking of, there was some acrimony and so on, but by the time they come down, they said, both sides, obviously, if it's mediation is to succeed, both sides would want to sort out the matter. And having, as Robert has said, having spent the 2 or 3 days sitting and mediating, they've looked at every aspect of matter. The chance, they shake hands on the deal, and there's no doubt that the mediator will assist them to come out with a written terms of settlement, which is binding on parties, and then you don't have to go to court with the all the other issues about whether the shorties or whether he had lost money from his contractors. You're then going to sue on the agreement which was arrived at in front of a respectable arbitrator, who mediator. Will the mediator give evidence in court?
Generally, you, as the mediator, you protect yourself by putting a clause into your terms of engagement saying you won't give evidence in court, because you want to take away from the parties that possibility. But the deal will be very simple. X pays Y so much, and the arbitration is discontinued. And so it's a very simple contract, and you can then enforce that in court very straightforwardly.
Raj wanted to say something about it.
No, I was going to ask another question. Have we finished it?
Before that, David, anything on this enforcement part of it?
A slight caveat, as you will have gathered from the mock mediation, one of the ways in which mediation can be successful is where you construct a package which involves some other business or other transaction as part of the consideration for the settlement. And that may not necessarily be as simple as signing a contract, A pays B $50 million. It may involve quite a complex negotiation of a parallel transaction. As you will have gathered from the introductions, I do an enormous amount of oil and gas work internationally, as well as electricity work. And the mediations I've been involved in, where they've been successful, have almost invariably involved some kind of parallel transaction, incepting as a result of the mediation. But the result of that is that, generally speaking, what happens is that you beaver away over endless cups of coffee, and you get to about 4 o'clock in the morning. Lawyers like me have had enough. You have a framework which you can sign up to, and a good mediator is often quite helpful in drafting that framework agreement, which is then actually subject to contract. And then there'll be negotiations going on for the next 3 or 4 weeks while you bring all the strands of the package together. But it still works, and the mediator is still sitting there in the background. And if the package begins to fall apart, you can always reconvene. So I just think it's quite important to understand that it's not every mediation that ends up with a simple A's going to pay B X dollars. You can end up with some quite complex settlements.
Thank you, David. Let's move on to another question then.
Yeah, Robert, you mentioned that you can do away with experts, but what happens if the dispute is a genuine disagreement about a technical issue? How is the mediation going to be able to bridge that that gap? Or are you suggesting that the mediation is just going to sidestep it and look at other things?
It all depends on the dispute, but you're absolutely right. If it's something as specific as, say, this power station boiler doesn't come up to specification, well, first of all, I would say, of course, think about mediation, but also think about a simple expert determination. If you've got a nice, simple
straightforward technical dispute like that. You can simply bring in an expert on power station boilers, give him all the papers, let him visit the boiler, and you can have very quick submissions and he can make a decision. So that would be one way of dealing with that very specific sort of case. But yes, if you've got something that is technical like that, then having an expert is almost inevitable. But in my experience, those are the minority. For most cases, the parties themselves, as you saw in the mock mediation, the people who are actually involved on the two sides, they've generally got enough technical expertise in-house to come up with what's necessary to achieve a deal. Getting experts is something you need to do when you've got to persuade a tribunal, whether it's an arbitrator or a judge, about something. But the beauty of mediation is you're not trying to persuade the mediator at all. He's quite irrelevant. All you're trying to do is explain your case to the other side. And the other side have got their in-house engineers. And so that's how you would avoid bringing in third-party engineers by or technical people. By using the in-house expertise.
I would like to add to that, Raj, that ladies and gentlemen, but in this mediation, in a mediation, by the time the parties agree to mediate the dispute, they've already been advised at great length by their experts. The technical subject is involved. People like Andrew has already spent, been collected his large fee and given you all the advice you need. You know exactly where you stand on the basis of experts. But both sides will be in that situation, so they won't really need to use the expert in the mediation process, right?
Right. Andrew, okay.
Sorry, just one further point. I know you're talking about experts, but for the actual mediator as well, I've been involved in mediations back in Hong Kong that's involved high-level mediators who are very technically competent, heavy engineering, technical disputes, for example, long-span cable stay bridges back in Hong Kong, which are very technically challenging, and those sort of, you know, experienced mediators. They're technically, they can understand, you know, those aspects very, very fast, and you know, they can understand the complexities, which does help either party within that mediation. Yeah.
Yes. Gentleman in black behind Raj.
Hello. Well, good evening, Dr. Robert and others. I'm Dr. Ishak from Faculty of Law, Multimedia University. I have a few questions to ask. The first is, what are the qualifications to be a good mediator? Second, what are the essential attributes that a person must have in order to be a good mediator? And my third question is that, in a typical mediation session, both parties must consent to have their issues mediated by a chosen mediator. And at the end of the process, there is a, what I call an agreement to a settlement. Now, in coming up with the written agreement, who prepares for the agreement itself? Does the mediator draft it, and then at the very moment of the settlement being reached, both parties sign in the presence of the mediator, or it can be delayed somehow to another date where both parties have to sign it somehow? Thank you very much.
Right. Well, I'll start on that, and I'm sure my colleagues can add to it. You've raised two broad and very important questions. The first is, what makes for a good mediator? And I would say the crucial thing is the ability to listen. Not all lawyers are good at listening. All lawyers are good at talking,
but not many are good at listening, and it's the listening that's crucial. Because if you listen very carefully to what people are saying, you're not only hearing what they're telling you in words, but you're also picking up the body language and the subtleties of what lies behind what they're saying. And you need to get a grip on that, because that enables you to say to yourself, right, well, the issue that really matters to that person is so-and-so. He might be talking about money, but what he really wants is an apology, that sort of thing. So being able to listen is the crucial thing. And the other important issue you raised was, what about the drafting of the settlement agreement? Each mediator has their own style. What I do is I send out, in advance of the mediation, what I call exercises, things where I suggest that the parties think about the following, and I have a list of things, would they identify what the costs of fighting all the way to the end of a long trial will be, because obviously that's something they need to take into account, and things like that. But one of the things I always say is bring along a laptop, and from the moment the mediation starts, start putting down the sort of terms you want to see in a deal, so that when you get to the point where you are going to shake hands, each side has already identified what matters to them. They then just email them to each other, and very quickly, using those two templates, you can put together one that satisfies both sides. And if you've got a good laptop and the two cooperative people, it's very easy to actually amalgamate the thinking of the two parties. But that is obviously an important issue. Right. Well, in the UK, there's no regulation, so anyone could say, I'm a mediator. But of course, they won't get any work, because no one will accept that they are a mediator. And a course that is very popular in the UK is the training course run by CEDR, C-E-D-R, the Centre for Effective Dispute Resolution. It's 70 Fleet Street in London. It's quite an expensive course. When I did it, it was many years ago in the 90s, and it was a very cheap course because I was one of the first people to do it. But now it's a very expensive one. But it's very good training. And if you've done that, then you will know how to mediate, and people will accept that if you're a CEDR-accredited mediator, that you know how to do it. And so that's what happens. I agree, anyone could claim to be a mediator, but they won't get any business, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, in addition to CEDA, I think the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators is also seeing the value in mediation, and I think it's beginning to have equivalent qualifications in mediation. And that's internationally recognized. For arbitrators, it's the gold standard. So that's another route you might want to consider.
Right, somebody at the back there.
Yes, question. My name is Primal Edward. To you, Robert. I'll stand up. I think none of you can see me from there. Thank you very much for the for the story of the little old lady in the urn. And what was interesting about that, I think, was the fact that she was not represented. And it'd be interesting for me to have your feedback on doing all the mediations you've done, whether you found lawyers being present at mediations a handicap, or was it actually beneficial? And does it vary according to the type of dispute it is? Thank you.
Well, thank you, Primula, for that. Primula is in-house counsel who's an expert on FIPSOs, floating platforms in oil fields.
so I know this is a home territory. The question about lawyers is a very important one, and mediators differ in their views about what lawyers bring to the party. My own experience is that lawyers are generally, and I say generally, not universally, but generally a good thing, because when it comes to drafting the agreement, they will draft with confidence and you'll get the deal once the parties actually want to sign up. And they're also good where clients who haven't got a legal background want a bit of reassurance from their own lawyer, and if he's or she is sitting there, then they can turn to them and say, is this okay? And the lawyer will say, yep, that's fine. And those two aspects, giving reassurance to the client and drafting the agreement, I think are the key elements for why lawyers should be at mediations. But there are some lawyers who are very obstructive. Maybe they think, well, if we torpedo this deal, then we'll go on and have a six-week hearing and that will be more lucrative. But I haven't encountered those lawyers. The ones I encounter are all very helpful and cooperative.
I've no doubt that the little old lady, Premila, you're talking a little old lady with the three children, I've no doubt there was a clever lawyer, Raj Navaratnam, or somebody in the background telling her, this is what you do, you turn up with the three children and the urn.
just one more observation in response to that very interesting question, the role of lawyers. I've actually found that a few mediations which I've attended as the legal representative of one of the parties, that it is actually a unique opportunity which you never normally have to, in the opening particularly at the opening presentation at the beginning, to talk direct, not to your opposite number. You don't look at him, you look at the managing director on the other side, because you never normally get a chance to do that as an advocate or lawyer for a party. And if you're very clever, you can use it as an opportunity to convince him that the case which his lawyer has been saying is a load of rubbish has actually got a little bit of credibility in it. And that's one of the most valuable things you can do. And it's actually one of the reasons why I don't regard mediation as cutting the lawyers out of a lot of business. Because a good advocate who knows how to handle a mediation can serve his clients proud by turning up and doing the opening presentation.
Said wine is being served. And I like my white wine chilled. It's probably warming up there. Ladies and gentlemen, mediation is not yet an in thing in this country, but it's very definitely in the pipeline. In Singapore, it's become very successful because the courts now have the power to direct the parties to try and mediate, and mediators are in great demand in Singapore because there's this court-enforced mediation. I think that's in the pipeline here. There are in many areas where mediation actually is taking place. I've been chairman of a committee for a number of years. We call it the mediation insurance mediation bureau and the banking in mediation bureau. That's what it was originally called. It's just about to take off as a what do you call this? We are about to take a leaf out of the British book to our mediation bureau is going to metamorphose into an ombudsman scheme, but it's still mediation. The mediators in the insurance and banking mediation bureaus sit as mediators, and if they cannot mediate, they then adjudicate. And quite a lot of the work, I've been looking after this for many years until very recently, quite a lot of the people we have there, we get retired people who just didn't make it to becoming judges and so on to sit there, and they act as very efficient mediators, and if they cannot sort it out, but about 30-40% of the work that they do is mediation, and then the other 70% will be where they could sort it out, they then adjudicate. So it's on in the pipeline, and I was a bit worried whether a few people will, because mediation has not caught on here, I was not sure whether people will turn up for this meeting, but it must be the Robert Gaitskell's reputation was there. I think that's probably why you came, or because mediation is not caught on yet. But it's very definitely, you're fortunate in having had the opportunity of listening to an expert on mediation, and we are even more fortunate, all of us are fortunate in having that mock mediation thing. It's a eye-opener, I think, to many of you. You can have an idea now what actually could happen. And with that, I think we want to show our appreciation to Robert Gaitskell and David Meldon and Andrew Merrillies in the usual way. Thank you very much.
Henshi, before we let you go, if you could just kindly present the tokens of appreciation to our presenters this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, can we please put our hands together for Mr. Dr. Robert Gaitskell? And David Meldon, thank you so much. Last but not least, Andrew. And on behalf of Dr. Sundra, thank you so much, Tanshri, for moderating this session. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your attention. Do you stick back, stay with us for some coffee, tea, and wine, and till the next time, thank you. Good evening.